Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for your people in the house of the Lord. Thank you for speaking to us and encouraging us today in the middle of, Lord God, so much stuff going on in the world right now. You are at work, and you are going to rise above it, and you are going to lift us up out of the darkness and into your light. We give you praise and thanks, Lord God, for what you're doing in your church. And Lord, we're thankful that we are your church, part of it, Lord God, that we are included because we've come to know Jesus. And I do pray, Lord God, if somebody is sitting in the sanctuary today and they are not in relationship with Jesus, that they would realize this very moment that could change in a second. All they need to do is believe on you. Believe, Lord, in your death and burial and your resurrection. Lord God, come into a personal relationship with you. I pray, Lord God, that they would make that choice today. Lord, it's an everlasting choice, and I pray, Lord, that your Spirit would speak to all your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Last Sunday was Resurrection Sunday. We talked about his resurrection is our resurrection. We know that because he lives, because he was dead and lives again, that we also shall live. We know that because he had a resurrection from the dead, that even we, though we die, because we are in him, we will be resurrected as well, and we will have everlasting life. But did you know that resurrection power is already at work for you? We're going to have a personal resurrection one day after we pass from this life and Jesus comes again. But did you know that resurrection power is already at work in the life of the believer? As a matter of fact, it's already in you. And I want to talk to you about that this morning. Residing resurrection power. It's not something that we're hoping for. It's something that's present now. Let me show you what the Bible says in Ephesians 3 and 20. The New Living Translation says, "Now all glory to God who is able, through his mighty power at work," say these two words with me, "within us, to accomplish infinitely more than we might ask or think." You're probably more familiar with the New King James. It says, "Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think," highlighted here, "according to the power that works in us." I think there's a lot of believers that think that God is going to do his work out there somehow and it's going to reach us, but he actually starts the work in us. Because the resurrection power is resident within us when we became followers of Jesus Christ. We serve a God with an exceedingly abundantly above power. Can I get a witness? A God with an exceedingly abundantly above power who also just happens to have an exceedingly abundantly above mentality toward us. It isn't that he's able but won't, it's that he is able and willing. He has an exceedingly abundantly above desire to work in the life of his sons and daughters. Now, I don't think we do it consciously, that we don't do it on purpose, but church, we limit God. We tie his hands, not because we're trying to, but because we don't give him credit for his exceedingly abundantly above willingness to work on our behalf. We're convinced that we need to convince God to bless us, and that's not Bible. You don't need to convince God to bless you. You just got to ask. Jesus said, "Whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you." We somehow think that somehow we got to work God up a little bit, that we got to convince him, that we've got to present an argument that'll get him excited about what's going on in our lives. You're not giving God credit for the exceedingly abundantly above desire that he has in his heart to move in your life. So we pray small, safe prayers. You know, the kind that in all honesty probably do not require a lot of faith if we're doing any praying at all, because we don't believe We might confess that he's got more power to do infinitely above all that we could ask or imagine, but we don't believe he'll really do it. It's about time we turned up our faith. It's about time we leaned into what the Word of God said. It's about time that we start repeating what the Word of God says instead of what bad theology has taught us. When is the last time you asked God to do something ridiculously big? And if he hasn't done it yet, why have you stopped asking? When is the last time we truly gave him a prayer request that allowed him to demonstrate his exceedingly abundantly power? When is the last time our faith made a demand or a draw upon his power? I'm reminded of the instance in the Bible, in the Gospels, when Jesus was on his way to heal another person, and there was a woman with the issue of blood who did not announce herself, who did not call out on the name of Jesus and saw that there was a crowd around him. In fact, she wasn't even supposed to be in that crowd because her condition made her ceremonially unclean and she wasn't supposed to be around people. But she determined, if I just touch him, I will be healed. And she touched him without announcement, and Jesus stopped in his tracks and said, "Who touched me?" He didn't say, "Who spoke out to me?" He said, "Who touched me?" In other words, somebody made a demand. Somebody's faith made a demand on my power. When is the last time your faith, your prayer, has made a draw upon the power of Jesus Christ? When is the last time you had the courage to pray a prayer so big that you felt silly praying it? Do we think that we're presuming too much to ask God for big, impossible things that are going to take a miracle? Or do we not want God to move in a mighty way? Some people just want a quiet church. Some people just want an easygoing experience. I want a life-transforming experience. I want a supernatural divine display of God's power. I want to lay my hands on the sick and watch them recover. I want to hear about the testimonies of the supernatural taking place. I want the church to step back into its birthright. Or is it that we don't want to end up embarrassed because we shot for the moon and fell short? So we're just going to pray safe prayers. Prayers that don't require a lot of faith. What I'm trying to stir up in you this morning is a faith that will take God at his word. I'm not trying to make something up, trying to hype you into something that isn't true. I'm trying to hype you into the word of God. Research the word of God and see that resurrection power is residing in you. The exceedingly abundantly above what we ask or think is according to the power that already works in us. Not will work in us someday, not that we will step into someday, not that we will discover when we get to the other side, but already works in us. For something to rise up in you that says, "I'm believing God for exceedingly abundantly above." And by the way, his word says that power is in us already. See, I don't think any of us truly realize who we are in Jesus and what he's planted in us. But I do think now is the season of our lives to start tapping into it. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 16 through 20 from the New Living Translation. The Apostle Paul says, "I have not stopped thanking God for you. I pray for you constantly, asking God, the glorious Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, to give you spiritual wisdom and insight so that you might grow in your knowledge of God. I pray that your hearts will be flooded with light so that you can understand the confident hope he has given to those he called." You know he's called you, right? confident hope to those he called, his holy people who are his rich and glorious inheritance. And here's the verse I love. I also pray that you will understand the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe in him. This is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead and seated him in the place of honor at God's right hand in the heavenly realms. The same power with which Christ was raised from the dead is the same power at work in you and me. Residing resurrection power is in the spirit of every believer, and it's time to wake it up from its sleep. There it is right there, Scripture. Resurrection power, the same power that raised Christ from the dead at work in us. The Apostle Paul really wanted the church to get this, and I agree with him. God in heaven, give us the spirit of wisdom and power and revelation. Let the eyes of our understanding be enlightened that we may know, experience, and operate in the power of God, in resurrection power. Church, God doesn't just have a few tricks up his sleeve. He's not the Wizard of Oz who puts on a show outwardly and is just a weird little man behind a curtain, who has a few tricks to convince people that he's something that he's not. No, we're talking about the God of the universe. We're talking about the God with such power in his voice that he can say, "Let there be light," and suddenly the world bursts with light. We're not talking about a God who has only a minuscule amount of power that he reserves for only the most crucial use, but it is the incredible greatness of God's power for us and in us. Resurrection power. What has died in you that must be brought back to life? What has been killed off by your many disappointments, discouragements, struggles, and negative life experiences? Because yes, even we as followers of Christ deal with those. But what have we allowed to be killed off in our life because of them? What have the lies and the deceptions of the enemy stolen from you? What has bad Bible teaching steered you away from? Can I tell you this morning, it's not too late. Those things can come back to life again. God's exceedingly abundantly above what we ask or think power is available and ready to work on your behalf and through you if you will ignite it with your faith. He will bring back to life things that he meant to live, but we have allowed to die. Purposes and callings, dreams and desires, relationships and opportunities that we let escape us, that God had brought into our lives. Can I tell you that the gifts and the calling of God are without repentance? He didn't change his mind, and if he meant for it to live in you, it will live again. It's not too late, because there is residing resurrection power at work. I don't care how many years you got on your calendar. I don't care how many life experiences have tried to tell you otherwise. I don't care how many badly informed Bible teachers have taught you something different. There is resurrection power at work in every child of God, and things that have died are going to come back to life if you'll root your faith down into that power. Read about the exploits of the early church. You ought to look hard at the book of Acts. Modern church leaders want to reason the book of Acts all away, saying that, well, it's a new era and God doesn't move that way anymore. And they say that the demonstration of power is now no longer necessary, but it's also not the will of God. And they will even tell you that it's of the devil if it's in the spirit. I beg to differ. The book of Acts is not a history book. It is a book for theology, because the Bible says all scripture has been given by inspiration of God, and it's good for doctrine, and it's good for teaching, and it's good for instruction. We need to look at the book of Acts as a roadmap for how the church in 2021 ought to look. People walking in power. People walking in holiness. People walking in the righteousness of God. People fellowshipping with one another. People moving. There need to be some Peter and Johns who see the beggar along the way and say, I don't have any money in my pocket, but I know the one that can lift you up out of your sickness and take him by the hand and lift him up. There ought to be that kind of demonstration for every child of God, not just for the people that hold a microphone. 1 Thessalonians 1, 4 and 5 say, we know, dear brothers and sisters, that God loves you and has chosen you to be his own people. Isn't that awesome? For when we brought you the good news, it was not only with words, but also with power. That's what we've got to get back to. We are so good with song sets and sermons. It's about time for there to be power to back up the things that we say. For the Holy Spirit gave you full assurance that what we said was true. The church has traded the power and presence of God for wordy songs and clever sermons. It's become a let's convince the world by our words approach. And yet Scripture says the kingdom is not in word only, but also in power. Words have their place, but they ought to be confirmed by signs following. Well, who says, Pastor Jeff? Well, God says. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 16 and verse 20. The disciples went everywhere and preached, and the Lord worked through them, confirming what they said by many, not a few tricks, but by many miraculous signs. Well, Pastor Jeff, that was for them and not for us. Who taught you that? Somebody who doesn't know their Bible. Somebody who didn't have enough faith to believe what the Bible said. Aren't you a disciple of Christ? Aren't you a follower of Jesus? What scripture anywhere says that the power of God was only for the original church? Show me, convince me. There are just way too many verses to the contrary of that thought. We have a resurrection power at work for us and in us. Isn't it time for us to tap into it with our faith? Isn't it about time we shut down the cute songs and the cute prayers and the clever sermons and start demonstrating faith? Being willing, instead of walking around people and not getting involved, to step right in and lay hands on them and pray for them and believe God to show something mighty. Shouldn't that be the way we walk and talk every day of our lives? If not, what are we doing here? The kingdom of God is not in word only, but also in power. Somebody needs to decide that's how they're going to operate. Someone needs to say that the church has settled for far less than the word of God says is ours, and I'm done settling. Is there anyone done settling? Standard operating procedure is resurrection power at work in the life of every believer. 1 Corinthians 2, verses 4 and 5, the Apostle Paul again wrote, and my message and my preaching were very plain. Rather than using clever and persuasive words, I relied only on the power of the Holy Spirit. The New King James says, I came in a demonstration of the Spirit and power. I did this so you would trust not in human wisdom, but in the power of God. I want people, when they consider Pastor Jeff, not to talk about my preaching, not to say I like the way he frames words, or I like the way they sing their songs, or I like the way they go about doing church. I want them to be able to say I can feel God all over him. There's something about God in him that draws me to him, and it ought to be the same for each and every one of you. There is resurrection power to bring life to that which is dead and dying, and we ought to be the conduit through which those things take place. The point of contact between the power of God and the needs of this world. Residing resurrection power. The power of the Holy Spirit, the demonstration that comes with the word. Enough talk. Show me the money. let's stop talking about what we're going to do and what we're going to be, and let's start being it and let's start doing it. This is what Overflow Church must strive for. Why, Pastor Jeff? Because the very Bible on which we build our faith tells us this is the way God designed it. Only the faithless say otherwise. Do you know why they want to tell you that the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit was only for the original church and not for today? Because they haven't got enough faith in their own hearts to believe what it's true, to believe that what it says is true. It takes faith. Listen, if you're going to walk with Jesus, you're not going to escape faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. We're going to have to live in it. It was faith that made you reach out to Jesus in the first place, was it not? Somebody, you heard the message from somebody, and it struck a chord in your heart, and you said, yeah, that's for me. And it took faith for you to believe the word. It's about time for those that have believed the word for their salvation to start believing the word for the power at work in them and to be used of God to make a difference in people's lives. I think all of us need the walls of our spiritual worldview kicked down and rebuilt for more capacity. I've been praying that personally a lot lately. Lord, increase my capacity. Increase my capacity to be used by you, to understand when you want to use me and how you want to use me. Increase my capacity for more of your presence and your glory in my life. Kick down the walls of my worldview. Whatever I'm seeing wrong, Lord God, I pray that you'll help me to see it your way. And even the things that I've got right, still, Lord God, help me to see it through your eyes. Increase my capacity. The power of God, the same power that raised up Jesus from the dead, is lying dormant in too many believers. Let's wake it up. Let us dare to believe. Let's take God at his word. Let's walk in such close fellowship with the Holy Spirit that we attack every day fearlessly and full of faith. You are not victims sent out in the world trying to survive. You are overcomers sent out to bring others into the victory. Well, we don't want to offend anyone. Would we rather they be unoffended or miraculously delivered? Well, we don't want to scare anyone because that Holy Ghost stuff is scary. Which is scarier, to lay hands on someone in faith or leave them to their illness? Well, we don't want any confrontation. It's about time some Christians cross the chicken line. If we don't confront the lies, the deceptions, the fears, the wounds, the injuries, and the misconceptions perpetrated by the devil, they will continue to have power in people's lives. It's about time that we opened up our mouth, opened up our hands, turned our feet in the direction where we can do some good for the kingdom. I want to echo with my life the desire of the Apostle Paul, who wrote in Philippians 3 and 10. I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised him from the dead. Residing resurrection power. The world needs more than a church that meets behind closed doors doing their own thing, praying cute little prayers, and paying into an occasional community outreach. The church itself needs more than some well-presented songs and clever sermons. The world and the church alike need the power and the presence of God. And since the Bible tells us that resurrection power is residing in every believer, it's time for us to set our roots down in that. What does that mean? How do we do that? I'm so glad you asked that question. It starts with God's word. It starts with the Bible. Know it. Apply it. Pray it. Live it. Breathe it. Reflect it. Speak it. Speak to the people in your life in agreement with the Bible. Speak what it says over your household, not what CNN says. Speak what the Word of God says over your family, over your prayer requests, over your desires and dreams, over your kingdom calling, over everything, and never, ever speak contrary to what God's Word says. If you're speaking contrary to God's Word, you're speaking contrary to the heart of God. Well, He wants to bless everyone else, but it's not. He doesn't want to bless me. What made you so special that you're the only person on the planet that God doesn't want to bless? Speak in agreement with the Word of God. We have neglected our Bibles. I'm sorry for being plain. No, I'm not. But we have neglected the Word of God. Some Christians can quote John 3:16, "For God so loved the world," and they can quote, "Jesus wept." But can they quote the verses that talk about the power of God residing in us? Can they quote the verses of that talk about life in Christ? Know the Word. It starts with the Word. And to the Word, add a genuine, connected prayer life to your knowledge of God's Word. The people of God have got to get back to the Word and to their prayer closets. Through prayer, the Holy Spirit can make God's Word come alive in your understanding and in your application of His Word in your life. The Word of God and prayer work, church. We're looking for a cheaper rate when the price has already been paid. We're looking for a shortcut when there's only one path and it's been cleared. The Word of God and prayer. There's no secret back door. There's no alternative route. There's only the hard work of prioritizing the Word of God and prayer. And when we do, you will just absolutely be blown away by the changes that'll take place in life. Because the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous avails much. It's the means by which the residing resurrection power will become energized in your life. But I'm not done yet. The Word of God and a prayer life. Don't leave home without it. But here's where the rubber meets the road for us modern day Christians. Pursue the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the agent of God, the person of the Godhead, released and at work in the earth today. Jesus had His day. He fulfilled His mission. He accomplished everything God had sent Him here to accomplish. And the Bible says that He ascended back to the right hand of God, where He has an ongoing assignment to intercede for us daily. Jesus had His day, and He sent to us His Holy Spirit. He sent to us the Holy Spirit. Jesus ascended back and He said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." The Gospel of John says He breathed on His disciples and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Acts 1:8 says, in Jesus speaking, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you." Jesus had even foretold of the Holy Spirit's indwelling presence even before this in the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verses 16 and 17. Notice how Jesus all by Himself indicates the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. He says, "I will ask the Father, and He will give you another advocate or comforter or helper who will never leave you. He is the Holy Spirit who leads you into all truth. The world cannot receive Him because it isn't looking for Him and doesn't recognize Him. But you know Him because He lives with you now and later will be in you." These are the days of "will be in you." He is not just with us and around us. He is in us. Resurrection power abiding in us. The glorious church that the Bible speaks about will be a body of believers, of Jesus followers who walk in the power of the Holy Spirit, who know how to pray faith-filled prayers, who take action daily rather than hoping for a someday resolution. Well, someday it's going to get better. Someday in the sweet by and by. We're just hanging on now till Jesus comes, and then it's all going to be good when we get to the other side. You need to take the Word of God, and you need to take it out of your prayer closet, and you need to walk after the leading of the Holy Spirit, and you need to make the day good. quick to pray, quick to believe, quick to approach an exceedingly abundantly above God with an exceedingly abundantly above expectation. Somebody ought to dial up their expectation. Speaking inspired, powerful, and biblical truth into every detail of life. The residing resurrection power in us will cause us to be the difference makers in Battle Creek, in Bedford Township, in Richland, and Augusta, and whatever else is around us. You're part of the world. If we will shake it out of its dormancy and into an awakened reality, it's the key from moving from you ain't seen nothing yet to look what the Lord has done. I'm ready to change my tune. I've been telling you for years, you ain't seen nothing yet. I'm ready to change my tune to look what the Lord has done. I want to stop talking about what the Lord is going to do, and I want to start testifying about what the Lord is doing. I want the people of God to stop giving lip service and start putting their lives into the power. I want the people of God to be able to stand up and testify, the Lord led me today and I crossed that chicken line and I spoke up when I heard people speaking and the Lord used me to lead them to their salvation. Or they were sick and we were in the doctor's office and they got a bad report and I laid hands on them and they had to go back into the doctor and have him explain why they were healed. You people are nuts. No, you people are Bible-believing people. That's where we got to go. If it's just about this gathering that we do in this comfortable little place that God has given us, we have missed the point. We have missed the point. Somebody needs to be hungry for God. We need to do the hard work that it takes. I know it's hard work, and I know you want to know who the next Jeopardy host is going to be. You know, I know that there are things that want your attention in this life, but the hard work is to turn off the distractions. To love the Word of God again. I'm not preaching against TV, and I'm not preaching against having a good time in this life. That's not what I'm saying, but I am saying we have made them the majority of our life and given God the dregs. The world deserves the dregs at best. It's hard work, but you open up the Word of God and start applying it to your life and watch change take place. You learn to pray, well, I don't have a big vocabulary like you do, Pastor Jeff, or others. It doesn't matter. God's not impressed by a big vocabulary. You know, he doesn't care. He doesn't care if you have a southern accent or not. He understands southern better than he does anything else, but he's still pretty good with all the rest. Love God enough to open His Word and to pray and be willing to say, Lord God, I've never been open to it before because the tradition I came out of didn't really emphasize it, but the Bible says you asked the Father to give me the Holy Spirit, and I want Him. I want Him to be at work in me. Residing resurrection power already at work in us who believe. Stand up with me this morning.